So this room might look very much like a garden shed, but it is in fact a store for these wood pellets, or something that's commonly known as biomass. And in today's video, we're going to look at whether biomass is a suitable fuel for you and your home that you might be considering moving to instead of an oil boiler or LPG gas boiler as we look to decarbonize heat in this country. Now, this room here is about to be filled with 7.5 tons of these pellets, so I think it's time to get out. Before we leave, we'll just hang this up because we don't want it getting buried under the biomass. Now, when it comes to biomass, probably the first thing that strikes is actually the amount of space that you need to have. The room behind us here is dedicated for storage of the pellets themselves. There's the chimney, so that means the boiler must be at the front. So let's go and have a closer look at that. So here's the biomass boiler for this property here. It's ironically housed inside what used to be the coal house, or even heating options before oil came along. When it comes to wood heating, there are a few other options. We've seen pellets, which are stored in the pellet store that's been built behind this coal house, but you can also get wood chips themselves, so unprocessed wood chips, or you can even get boilers that will burn complete logs. However, the downside of those is you need an incredible amount of space to dry them, and obviously a source of material. So most people go down the pellet route, because this boiler here is fully automatic. It's a Froling P4, 25 kilowatts that's been sized to meet the needs of the property. And it does everything from feed itself to putting the ash in its ash bins and cleans itself after each cycle. Now, there's a lot going on in this room if you're not used to plumbing systems, and certainly more than you'd expect to see with a conventional boiler system. There's the flow and return pipe that's pretty normal, but one major addition is this enormous buffer tank here, which will hold 1,000 litres of water. Now, the thinking behind that is it's not ideal to keep cycling wood pellet boilers on and off as you might do with a traditional gas or oil boiler. Once they're running, they're ideally kept running for a considerable amount of time to get the efficiency up to the maximum, so you start burning the wood and keep burning it until this 1,000 litre tank is full. And then once it's full and up to temperature, the property draws its hot water and heating needs from the buffer tank so that the boiler's not cycling all the time. So let's have a closer look at some of the other system components. I've removed the outer cover from the boiler so we can have a closer look at how the fuel handling system works and how it's automatic. So how do the pellets get from the pellet store behind us into this small cylinder here, which is right next to the boiler? Now, the clever bit is it's all done by vacuum. So yes, just like you'd have in your home to suck up dust from the floor, this here, this motor here, is essentially a vacuum cleaner that sucks the pellets from the store that's behind us. Now, inside the store is another really clever bit called the mole. So the mole wanders around the store looking for pellets, particularly when it's empty, so you can maximize the pellets over the store. The pellets themselves are deposited into this tank, and then there's another clever bit. So pellets, as you move them around, they disintegrate and little bits of dust come off, and really you need to deal with that dust. So the waste air goes back up this other pipe here through this cyclone, just like you'd see in a Dyson Hoover. Everyone remembers seeing the clear bits on the side and all your dirt collecting inside. So it goes through that cyclone and then back into the store. So we're not drawing any damp air from outside and obviously risk getting the pellets wet in the store, which wouldn't be very good for them. So at the bottom of the cylinder where the pellets are stored, the pellets drop into this feed mechanism here for the boiler. So it's controlled by a stepper motor, and that turns the pellets very gradually and drops them into the tube. So it goes into the combustion chamber of the boiler. A few of the clever things while we're at this end, behind us here, there's a little, essentially like a heat gun, really, paint stripping heat gun. So that puts in an initial burst of hot air from an electric heater to ignite the pellets at the start of the cycle and get them going. And then at the end of the cycle here, there's a movable grate that pulls out from the boiler there to drop the ash into the ash bin. So speaking of ash, this boiler has two ash bins, one from the main combustion chamber and one from the heat exchanger. So you get quite large ash from the actual combustion chamber itself. So that's in here. If we just open this door, we can pull out the ash chamber there. So there's one from the from the combustion chamber. And there's a second one here with finer ash that you can see just coming out there from the heat exchanger itself. Let's have a look inside the boiler itself to see what actually happens with those pellets. Where this comes in. So you can see there's quite a bit of ash in here, so the boiler's probably due for a service soon. At the back, they've got an induced draft fan, so that again is linked to the control system, so the pellets burn as efficiently as possible, so it can control the amount of air and the speed of the boiler burn. Inside here, you can see the second heat exchanger, and these springs here, when they move up and down, they actually clean the boiler itself. Let's see if we can get them to operate. If we remove this dust, we'll have a look in the primary heat exchanger. Remove this cover. And there we can see down into the heat exchanger itself. So the pellets drop from our hopper into the grate at the bottom, and that's where they're heated and burned. Obviously the combustion gases then come up through this first heat exchanger, down through the second heat exchanger, then back up through the third one, and then obviously the exhaust gases go out through the fan and then up the flue system. So all in all, quite an efficient system, relatively simple. It is a fire at the end of the day, but it's incredibly well controlled fire. Now this all may seem incredibly complicated, but fear not, the brains of the operation are behind this panel here. So inside here are all the electronics to control everything from the operation of the boiler, the control of the pellets making their way into the store, and the levels. You can tell it how many tons of pellets are in the store. It controls the pumps into the buffer tank. It even has the temperature sensors for the buffer tank as well. And it will connect to the internet, and you can access this all through an app. So even if you're away, you can check that your boiler is working exactly as it should be. Now, hopefully I can put this back together and we'll go and have a look at how the pellet store gets filled. When it comes to pellets, there are a few choices in terms of how you have them delivered and stored. You can buy pellets in bags and manually load them into a boiler or a storage silo, but the most efficient way is to have them delivered in bulk. It's cheaper, but when it comes to bulk deliveries, the more pellets you have delivered in one go, the cheaper it becomes, which then means you need somewhere to store them. Now, this pellet store here has been designed to match the buildings around it, but you can buy pre-manufactured stores in a range of shapes and tonnages depending upon the situation of the boiler. When pellets are delivered, they're delivered in a tanker that looks pretty much like an oil tanker, except a little bit bigger, because pellets again take up more room when they're being transported. There is a limit to how far the pellets can be blown from the tanker into the store, and that limit is set by basically, if you try to push them too far, the truck needs too much pressure, and that can actually break the pellets apart. To reduce the pressure on the pellets when they're being delivered, pellets are also sucked and blown at the same time. And there's also a dust bag fitted to the pellet delivery system to collect the dust, because even with the best precautions in the world, as pellets bang into each other, they do tend to create a little bit of dust, and you want that collecting. The pellet store itself has a few design features. There's two pipes, so there's one for the pellets to be blown in, and there's one for that delivery air to be extracted out from and the dust collected, and there's a mains power supply needed for the equipment that goes with that. The trucks themselves tend to measure the delivery, so we've just had a delivery here of 7.5 tons, which has almost filled the store, which will take 8 tons. Inside the store, there's a special impact mat, so that again, we're protecting the pellets when they're delivered. They have a soft landing when they hit that rubber mat, so they stay as comfortable as possible. So we've completed the delivery on this project. All that remains now is to drop the pellet mold back into the store, and the boiler can start up again and start heating the house and giving hot water. some precautions around fuel storage areas. The pellets themselves outgas carbon monoxide, so make sure the pellet store is adequately ventilated before entering. Always wear a dust mask and no fire or open flames or smoking while you're in there. Also be careful of deep storage like we've seen today. You could actually sink underneath the pellets and no one might even know you're in there. And now for some free cash from the government. Biomass boilers are included as part of the boiler upgrade scheme that's recently been launched by the UK government. They're only allowed if they're on rural properties that aren't connected to the gas network, and so it could be a great option, particularly if it's difficult to upgrade the insulation within your property. You should always try and do that anyway, but if you can take your insulation in your property to a higher level, it may be worth looking at an air source or a ground source heat pump that are also included in that scheme, and that doesn't exclude rural properties. We're going to be making some more videos about ground source and air source heat pumps, so stay tuned to the channel for that. We'd love to get your questions about this installation that you've seen here. Was there anything else you'd like to know? Is there any other suggestions that you'd like to make for anyone who's looking to adopt a biomass heating system? And we hope to get those comments below, and hopefully we'll see you on the next video.